Well, welcome and good morning. I'm Jeremy, one of the pastors here at The Axis. And this morning I have the privilege and task of guiding us in week four of our Advent Sundays, of guiding us to Jesus by considering the topic of hope. And I will do so by working through the pages of Scripture from Genesis 1 to Revelation 22. Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Genesis 1:31, and God saw that everything he had made, and behold, it was very good. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made, and he said to the woman, "Did God actually say?" In other words, can his word be trusted? Can he be trusted? Well, Adam and Eve were deceived. Being tempted by the tempter, they chose to do their own thing in their own way, and this is the very essence of sin. Mankind doing their own thing in their own way, as opposed to doing God's thing in God's way. In Genesis 3:6, so the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was a delight to the eyes and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise. She took of its fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loincloths. These fig leaves, our attempt to make it right, our attempt to cope with our shame and our loss, trying now to live with our sin, making accommodation for what sin needs to bring into our life. At best, this fig leaf is self-righteousness, our attempt to save ourselves, self-salvation, us trying to fix our mess, our problem, our sin. Sin and shame and sadness and separation and loneliness, all of this and so much more entered the world, our world, right then and right there. Genesis 3, 6 and 7. Well, then they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. They hid. They felt fear for the first time. Guilt. They felt guilt for the first time. The sound that they grew to love and anticipate of God making his way through the garden to them, hearing it now induces panic and anxiety. God making his way near to them was suddenly terrifying. A strange new reality for our first parents, Adam and Eve. Genesis 3:21, and the Lord God made for Adam and for his wife garments of skins and clothed them. Death. You see, the first death was a separation and fear that Adam and Eve experienced between themselves and God, their Father, their Creator. And all of us experience this. If you're alive, you've experienced this separation and this fear. We're born into this reality. But the second death, the death of an animal, the slaughtering of an animal sacrifice, provided temporary coverings for the nakedness and shame of mankind. The fig leaf was not enough. There had to be a shedding of blood. Without the shedding of blood, we're told in Hebrews, there is no forgiveness or remission of sins. So the fig leaf was not enough. The separation between God and mankind is so settled. It's firmly settled. In Genesis 3:23, the Lord God sent Adam and Eve out of the Garden of Eden to work the ground from which he was taken. Sent out of the garden. Sent out of paradise. Most significantly, sent out of the presence of God. Genesis 3:24. He drove out the man, and at the east of the Garden of Eden, he placed the cherubim, an angel, with a flaming sword that turned every way to guard the way to the tree of life. The flaming sword to keep them away. This is judgment. But it's also mercy to protect them from his consuming holiness. God said in Genesis 3:19, by the sweat of your face you shall eat bread until you return to the ground, until you return to the ground. For out of it you were taken, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Dust you shall return. till you return to the ground. Death. Man was not originally created to experience death. That's part of what makes it so complicated at funerals. We were never intended to be able to cope with death, never knowing exactly the words to say or how to handle it emotionally. It is so far into our created essence and being. It happened after we were created. Our bodies aren't modified to handle it. You shall return to the dust. Death comes through sin. You see, Adam acted for us all, therefore we're all born in a sinful condition. And so simply put, in Adam, we all die. Through Adam, we all die. Romans 5:12 says, therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, Adam, and death through sin, so death spread to all men because all sinned. And death reigned from Adam to Moses. Now, you remember Moses probably, the fellow with the Ten Commandments, right? Early in our books, early in our Bible, tells us about Moses, that he was given these Ten Commandments, ten rules, that when we obeyed them perfectly, we will be allowed to be at peace at some level with God, but those commandments were too difficult for us to keep all the time. Romans 3:22 says, there is no distinction or difference, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. No one can keep these commandments all the time and perfectly. Romans 3:10 says, as it is written, in fact, none is righteous, no, not one. No one understands, no one seeks for God. And proof of that, I think, you could even go back to Genesis 3, when Adam and Eve go and hide themselves, who pursued who? God pursued Adam. There's nothing in our nature, there's nothing in us that desires God unless God placed that desire in us. We always choose our way. We always choose the opposite way of what he has for us. No one seeks for God, for all have turned aside. Together they become worthless. No one does good, not even one. Their throat is an open grave. They use their tongues to deceive. The venom of asps is under their lips. Their mouth is full of curses and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. In their paths are ruin and misery, and the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now, we don't like to hear this. We're good people. We don't like to think this is true of us. It might be true for some people, but not for us. But I believe the reason we don't like this is because it is true. And deep down, we know that these words provide for us a mirror of reality that's tough to accept. But perhaps the worst part about this isn't the shame that we feel when we think about our sin, but it's the judgment that we face, the judgment that we fear. We know at the end of our life, there's going to have to be some sort of justification or making a settling of accounts for us and our sin. We're going to have to answer to something, to somebody, to someone for the wrong that we've done. We feel this. Romans 6:23 pulls this out and says the wages, the price, the fee of sin is death. Ephesians 2:1, and we were all dead in the trespasses and sins in which we once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince, Satan, the serpent there in the garden, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. You're not out of this. You're included in this, among whom we all once lived, in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and we all were children of wrath like the rest of mankind. So as a way of addressing this sin, this guilt, this judgment, we could, of course, try to keep the Ten Commandments better. But when we failed, not if, but when we failed, we were taught that we could offer up sacrifices, mirroring the first sacrifice of the animal in the garden being slaughtered to cover. We could offer sacrifices that would then atone for our sins. But the thing is that only worked temporarily. And besides, what would it do with all the sins that we committed that we weren't aware of? And what about all the things that we were supposed to do that would be helpful and beautiful that we refused to do? So there's the sins of commission, the things that we commit. There's sins of omission, the things that we are good that we should do, but we don't. We omit them. But then what about all the sins of others against us? Who's going to answer for these things? How's there going to be justice for these things? So yes, there's these sacrifices, but never enough to rid us of our problem completely and fully. Hebrews 10 tells us this, but in these sacrifices of these priests, there's a reminder of sins every year. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Sacrifices in the Old Testament covered sin temporarily, but they did not remove our sin. They did not take it away. Sacrifices did not treat our sins as if they had never happened. They just covered them temporarily. And it says here in Hebrews 10, and every priest stands daily at his service, every day, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which in the big picture can never take away sins. So given the situation that mankind is in, unless something changes, something drastic, mankind is left in hopelessness. There is no reason to hope. Our reality is hopeless. Up until this point in our story, mankind's best day might not be hopeless, but definitely despair. There's failure. All of us. We've been tricked, we've been fooled, we've been deceived. We're without God. We're without hope in this world. And this is true for all of us. And it's permanent, it's always, and it's fixed forever for every single one of us. Echoing Amos in chapter 5, verse 1 in your Old Testament. Fallen, no more to rise. Forsaken, with none to raise us up. Hopeless. But what else did God say in the garden? Back in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. He said, I will put enmity between you, the snake, the serpent, Satan. I'm going to put enmity between you and the woman. Between your offspring and her offspring. He, her offspring, will bruise your head. And you will bruise his heel. But what does this future promise mean? I mean, does this leave the door open for a hint of mercy? Of something that would change maybe? I mean, God's curse on the serpent in particular was laced with a word of hope. God speaks directly to the serpent, that's Satan. And he says, the offspring of evil forces that are sent from Satan will merely strike the heel of the future offspring of Eve, the mother of all living. But the offspring of Eve will crush and destroy and give an eternal mortal wound to the skull of Satan, his kingdom. But who is the offspring? And how will we know when he's here? When will this all take place? I mean, there was a lot of talk about this stuff in the Old Testament. There was a lot of talk and chatter about this future champion offspring. The Messiah, the promised one, for hundreds of years. God spoke to his people through judges and kings and prophets and priests and teachers, but then silence. After the prophet Malachi in the Old Testament, or for fun, Malachi, if you want to get loose with it. After Malachi, there was nothing but silence from God for 400 years, the intertestamental period between Malachi and Matthew. 400 years, not a voice, not a word. Not a look from God to his people. Prophets, he would give messages to, boom, 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 with Malachi, whose last words involved a curse. Nothing but silence. Mankind questioned and struggled with all this before this silence. But now after the silence, we're pretty sure that they've mistaken and they've been talking about this future promise that's never even going to happen. Or perhaps mankind has messed up so tragically, so epically, that God is simply uninterested and he walked away. But regardless, this 400 years of silence, this hopelessness mounts, despair accumulates. And if you are one awaiting the Messiah through those 400 years, people don't even hardly remember what you're talking about. It's been forgotten. Hopeless. Silent. On one clear, cool night, approximately 2,000 years ago, an angel of the Lord appeared to shepherds out of nowhere. And the glory of the Lord shone around these shepherds, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not." The last word cursed in the Old Testament, the first word in the New Testament from God, "Fear not. For behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David, Bethlehem, a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Christ, the Lord. And I'll even give you a sign. You're going to find this baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a feeding trough." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth among peace among those with whom he is pleased." The Christ child? Like the promised one? The long-awaited Messiah? Yes, God's very own and only Son. You know this, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not shoulder the weight of the curse, which is death, any longer, but have eternal life. Those who simply believe in the Christ child, believe in the Savior, who believe in God's Son, will not perish, but have eternal life. That tells us that the original curse from the garden can be reversed. It's through Jesus. It's though Jesus, though he was in the form of God, he did not count equality with God as a thing to be grasped and held onto, but instead emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men through the offspring of Eve. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. He took the curse for us as us. Jesus is the image of the invisible God. He is the firstborn of all creation. For by Jesus, all things were created in heaven, on earth, visible, invisible, whether thrones, dominions, rulers, or authorities. All things were created through Jesus and for Jesus. And Jesus is before all things. And in Jesus, all things hold together. And Jesus is the head of the body, the church. He's the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in Christ Jesus, all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through Jesus Christ to reconcile to himself all things, to bring justice to all matters, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. He took this upon himself. He didn't outsource the suffering or the cross to someone else or leave it up to legalism or moralism for us to figure out. He took it upon himself and suffered through his blood on the cross. Now you who were once alienated and hostile in mind, doing your evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his own death, absorbing the consequence of the curse of our sin in the garden upon himself. It's through his death in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him, completely reversing the curse for you. It was while we were weak that at the right time Christ died for the ungodly, for one would scarcely die for a righteous person, right? Though perhaps for a good person, one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we're still rebel, sinner, angry, hating God, it's that time that Christ died for us. In Hebrews 9, when Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things that have come, then through the greater and more perfect tent, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation, he entered once for all. Not daily, like the other priests. He entered once for all into the holy places, not by means of goats and calves as sacrifices, but by means of his own blood, Jesus being the sacrifice to take away all sacrifices, thus securing our eternal redemption. For if the blood of goats and bulls and the sprinkling of defiled persons with the ashes of a heifer sanctified for the purification of the flesh, how much more? How much more with the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, how much more will Christ's blood purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Therefore, he is the mediator of a new and better covenant, so that those who are called may receive the opposite of the curse in the garden, eternal death and separation, so they might receive the promised eternal inheritance, since a death has occurred, his death, since his death has occurred that redeems them from the transgressions committed under the first covenant. Jesus has appeared already, once and for all, at the end of the ages, to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Ludicrous that God should die for us. Glorious that God should die for us. And just as it is appointed for man to die once and after comes judgment, so Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly waiting for him. And we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Christ Jesus once and for all. And every priest, remember, he stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down. He was finished. He didn't have to keep standing up. His job was over once and for all from the cross. To Tetelestai, it's finished. And he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. It's the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. There's no difference or distinction. All of us have fallen short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation, as a wrath sponge, wrath absorber, punishment taker, right? He put forth Christ Jesus as our propitiation to suffer the consequences of our sin and our action, shouldering the curse that we deserve to shoulder upon himself so that we don't have to. And he did this by his blood to be received simply by faith. This was to show God's righteousness because in his divine forbearance, he had in the Old Testament passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time so that he might be the just and justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. You see, the gospel tells us that Jesus is the new and greater and better representative, the one that we need. And for those who believe Jesus as Lord and Savior, their representative is no longer Adam, who failed as our representative. He was a terrible representative. He was awful. He led us to death. He led us to sin. But now Jesus, the Christ, he's the representative who has perfectly succeeded for us as us. Romans 5:18, therefore, as one trespass through Adam led to condemnation for all of us, so one act of righteousness through Christ leads to justification and life for all men. For as by one man's disobedience, Adam, the many were made sinners, so by one man's obedience, Jesus, the many will be made righteous. Remember, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. And whoever simply believes in him by faith is not condemned. It was for our sake that God made Jesus to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in Christ we might become the righteousness of God, fit for heaven, holy and blameless, above reproach before him. I want to finish reading Ephesians 2. Where we talked about, and you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our rebellion, our sins, and our trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. It is by grace that you have been saved And not only this, he's raised us up with him and seated us with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming eons and ages, he might show us the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing. It is the gift of God. It's not a result of your works or your fig leaves or your legalism, moralism, your rule keeping, your own efforts. You're trying to have your good outweigh your bad. It's not a result of any of this. It's only grace. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus. Born again, John would say, recreated in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. You see, Jesus earned us victory over sin through his perfect representative life. This provides us with hope. Jesus earned us victory over death through his sacrificial, substitutional death. This provides us with hope. Death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, be steadfast, be immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. This provides us with hope. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened up for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. This provides us with our hope. So even now, as we face sickness and sadness and even death, because of the person and the work of Jesus Christ and our faith in him, we no longer need to weep as those who have no hope. Nor do we need to laugh and have fun and live as those who have no hope. So, fellow believer in Christ Jesus, when you wait, fellow Christian, while you suffer, I want you to call this to mind and have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They're new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, therefore I hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. So as you deal with sickness and physical setbacks, call this to mind and have hope. As you struggle through relational conflict and tension within friendship, call this to mind and have hope. As you're persecuted for his name's sake, as you speak to others of the hope that you have in Jesus, call this to mind and have hope. As you stumble and fumble your way through your faith journey, call this to mind and have hope. As you fight substance abuse and pornography and other addictions, call this to mind and have hope. As you ache through financial stress, marital confusion, loneliness in your singleness, and questions surrounding infertility, call this to mind and have hope. As you long for and look for the new heavens and the new earth and the arrival of our King Jesus to come settle accounts and make everything right and make all things bad untrue, you call this to mind and you have hope that the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They're new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The priest stood every day to make sacrifices for the sins of the day before. Every day there's new mercies at your door, waiting for your failures, waiting for your inadequacies, waiting for your problems. His mercies are new every day. Great is his faithfulness. The Lord is your portion. Hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him. Wait for him. to the soul that seeks him. Seek him. He says if you do, you'll find him. It's good, good that you should wait. In our life of instant gratification, hear this. It is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. In the midst of your suffering, in the midst of your frustration, wait quietly with your eyes lifted higher than your frustration, higher than your suffering, to something better than deliverance from temporary physical suffering. Look to a new world free of sin and suffering. You're an ambassador passing through. This is not your home. Keep your eyes lifted to the horizon. How do we see and know the love of the Lord? Friend, we see God sending his only son to us to suffer as us for us. Utter selflessness. We look to the cross of Jesus Christ and we see Jesus suffering in our place, only doing this for us. Utter selflessness. Friend, if you want to know if you matter, you look at Christmas. God became flesh to rescue you. I love that line. And when he appeared, the soul felt its worth. When you realize what Christmas is, there's something down deep in you that says, I must matter to him at some level. I've got to matter. And if you want to know how much you matter, look at Easter, where God suffered and died for you. Those who aren't Christians yet, my friends, dig into the pages of Scripture and do it with a trusted friend. And stare at the work of Jesus as you learn it. Stare at the work of Jesus that he did as you, for you, until your heart melts. And it will. No one has ever been truly honest with themselves and stared at the cross of Jesus and not had their hearts melt and their joy be made full. And purpose and meaning come upon their life. Nobody. Nobody who's honestly looked at themselves or who they are and looked at Jesus Christ and what he's done and not melted. So if you think, well, I haven't melted, understand who you really are and look and look and stare. Your heart will melt. And remember Hebrews 9:28, that Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, he will appear a second time. Not to deal with sin, but to save those who eagerly are waiting for him. Therefore, like Joel says in chapter 2, let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. It is near. A day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness. For the day of the Lord is great and very awesome. Who in the world can endure it? Return to the Lord. The only ones who are able to endure the coming of the Lord are those who are hidden in Christ Jesus. And those who are hidden in Christ Jesus are those who return to the Lord. We return to the Lord by calling out to God, asking God to forgive us our sins, and welcome us back into friendship with him that's based solely on the work of Jesus Christ, our great high priest. So you, Hosea 12:6, so you, by the help of your God, hold fast to love and justice and wait continually for your God. Keep your eyes lifted. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For in the first heaven, the first earth had passed away and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them. Remember the garden? They were sent away. In the new heavens, they're together. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God, and he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death. Remember the garden, the curse? No more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore. The former things are gone. They're passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. In this we hope, eagerly awaiting. We started in Genesis 1:1. We'll end with the final verse of the New Testament. Surely I'm coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. the grace of the Lord Jesus be with you all. Amen. We're going to remember this magnificent grace of God towards us through communion, remembering the finished work of Jesus for us that changed our situation from utter hopelessness, always, eternally, to hopeful, radical hope, so hopeful that it changes our lives in this life and the life to come. The hope that we have in Christ changes everything, everything. And this is what we remember. We're going to take pieces of bread that are symbolic of the life that Jesus Christ lived, those 33 some years that he lived this life, perfect the entire time. He was holy and blameless so that he could be our representative for someone who was holy and blameless. So that bread is symbolic of his body, his life that he lived in the flesh, perfect for us, as us. We're going to take that and dip it into the juice or wine, that red liquid, symbolic of the death that he suffered in our place, receiving the curse as us, for us, so that death is no longer the end of our story, but the beginning, just the vehicle to greater life. That's so much better than this life. And if you're a Christian, I'll see you there. We hope in this. We rejoice in this. And we do as Jesus asked his disciples to do. When they took this, we remember what he's done for us. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your mercy and grace, your love towards us. Jesus, thank you for your faithfulness, your hard work, your mission to come and rescue a people who hated you, melting and softening their hearts along the way. Thank you, Spirit, for your activity in our lives, your relentless pursuit of us, convicting us of sin, leading us through repentance. Thank you for this magnificent work. We remember this now as we acknowledge that these are the gifts of God for the people of God. And we proclaim the mystery of the faith that Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ is coming again. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, our triune, magnificent, glorious God, be on this time of communion and remembering, and remain with us always, even to the end of the age. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.